girls' school, converts them with that, and has like a decoration, and then sponsors the boys' school. So if they do that, then the school comes out of the category of all the ones that touch.
Can I ask a question? I'm sure, of course. And it's a school that's not a when a school is jumping, do you have any input into the improvement plan that you have side of it? Do you work with the school to monitor the improvement or in any way?
Is this a school maybe that's gone into an asset category and then
becoming an academy?
Yeah, absolutely. So for example, if we talk about Wallasey School, we have a statutory duty to support challenging performance, so we will be in there. And we would like to work very cooperatively with sponsors, because the way we look at it, a lot of our statutory duty, and all our little children, all the best of our children, so we will be in there, and we have very good relationships with the head of the entity, who are very happy to continue with the work.
Chair, if I just briefly say, it is a lot down to the relationship the local authority has with the schools, particularly its academies. It's, as Sue said, been really strong in our role with championing children, and having a compelling place that we need to keep working together to bring children. And Sue has done a sterling job with the team, but Sue personally, and the ethos that she's developed with the team, that there is an excellent relationship with all our schools, regardless of their status, and that goes from primary, secondary, and special schools. You need that relationship to independence on each other and say we need to work with you to improve the children.
Yeah, just to say, I'm really concerned about the child schools and the foster categories going into academy and then, lose that. I understand why they lose it, but to lose it for 12 years, which almost put them in special schools for a long time.
I get the least.
Yeah, I mean, I get that we need time to establish ourselves, but my concern is that being true, if they haven't, the kids will somehow not be quite as well attended to. I know you're trying your hardest, and this is simply things like that, but I just want to try to provide a little bit, and it just needs to be a little bit faster. If the girls are going to do it, which is also very good, just decide to go to the academy. If it's something that they're doing essentially to cloak what's happening in the joining school, I'm sure that is not, that's not going to be any benefit to the kids and then do what it's like. I just wonder what can be done then. It seems like a
very simple.
If you really want to push, yeah, I might be so.
If that were the case, it does.
Yeah.
I think in terms of the Wallasey Federation, the DFE have come across something quite as interesting before, and they can see that there is huge capacity within the school, and there is some very good teaching going on in that school, very good teaching. I think the number of issues really, but the DFE could have proposed a different sponsor. But that makes it incredibly complicated because you would have a boys' school sponsored by an external sponsor, and you've got a good girls' school that's almost on the same site. So the DFE are trying to come up with a solution, and we'll wait and see what they say next week. One of the things I would say that would be involved with the school challenge the DFE is like, what difference is it going to make? Because they felt that one of the reasons the boys went into an offset category was there was so big, so concerned around the federation making work, which are the right of all the teaching and learning. So the one thing I'll say about Pensbury boys, their results have gone down a bit this year. However, part of that is to do with the reporting mechanism that happens, because they chose, there were a number of boys that best interests of the kids, but they're being demonised by the
My final question is that now that they can't be on that category, not just when they give it to the schools too, how is that going to reflect on this committee at all? Am I given to the book accepting the results of that
now in terms of coming together review. Now that review is
consideration for this evening is around the review of children. The review of children's centres and the ongoing developments around improvement plans. So whilst we've been looking at the review of children's centres, we haven't stopped looking at the improvements that are required, and I'll come on to that in a minute. But we've all agreed that it's probably time for radical change. Okay? I think some of the main reasons are that there hasn't been a comprehensive review undertaken since the inception of children's centres, which was probably around 2002. So we had short start local programmes that then started to develop into children's centres, and Wirral has 16 children's centres. It delivers from 18 buildings, and I believe it originally delivered from 24 buildings, some of which transitioned into the school assets. So we've still got 18 buildings that we're working from. There have been a number of changes to the local approach. So we have talked a little bit there in my introduction about the targeted service offer, looking at moving towards an early help offer and a targeted way of working for Wirral. And that is kind of really the direction travel of the government in terms of its changes to the children's centre guidance and the early help offer, that is looking to target those children most in need of services and move away from, not stop delivering, but move away from a universal delivery option, and we don't know where our vulnerable or most in need are. So there's also been a significant reduction in available resources. I've got the headlines about that I'll come on to in a minute. And we can't continue to do everything that we've done and get it right for children. So we've had to look more radically at our early years offer, aligned to the early help and based within the funding envelope, and considering the legal parameters for what early years, for where early years links. So there's a number of duties that we've got to report to and to make sure we get it right for those. There's also been several changes to the Ofsted inspection framework during that period of time, and we're probably just about to enter further consultation on the inspection framework for children's centres, and I think that the former framework has just been delivering for a little bit more than 12 months. So it's moved very, very rapidly, and each of those changes we need to be able to respond to or be in a position to respond to. So those are the kind of main areas of business. And I think that the other one, the one there at the bottom, that there has been some significant research that has been undertaken across a number of years, that the findings of that research are now coming to light. So we need to be aligned with what research is telling us to ensure our direction of travel for our women's children is taken into consideration what we know going forward, as opposed to what we assumed that we knew from a historic position. This is just a very quick summary of the finance position. So you can see that in 2012 we had 8.8 million to run for the service. In 2013-15 there were funding reductions of 2.8 million, which brings us down to 6 million. And the breakdown of that 6 million is that there is further reductions to be taken out of this next period of 1.5 million. And in 2013, 1.1 million moved to deliver fund support through the Gateway offer as part of targeted services. So that was moving all of the family support to deliver a collaborative offer for family support to ensure that we responded to those children and families that required service, often a joined up collaborative service, and that the referral and approach through the Gateway had somewhere to move those children to. So it's real dedicated family support that moves across the borough based on the needs of the families. And then the kind of hidden cost there is that there's £600,000 associated with pension costs and £500,000 associated with pension costs and fixed term costs of about £600,000. So that leaves us going forward with £2.3 million. really is a children centred service. And I thought that you would probably want to see that kind of highlighted in terms of all the agreements that have been taken forward. That's where we are now, and hence moving forward to review the service and consider everything that we need to look at to spend that right. What I also just want to say with that funding though as well is that that isn't counting the early education offer. So the 2, 3 and 4 year old education offer for funded places, either in schools or through provision, is around about £15 million. And health visiting moves back to be delivered through a commission with the local authority next year, is about £5 million. And whilst a lot of that is mandated, it's about making sure that collectively we spend the money as wisely as we possibly can, reduce duplication, target those most in need, and make sure that our systems and processes talk to each other so that we collectively know what we're about, what's our business. And that's coming through in the review. I just wanted to highlight some of the areas that we are currently looking at from the improvement plan. So we've got the review that's being taken forward through a multi-agency, almost a core group, a task management of quite our partners. And then these are the things that are continuing to happen. So leadership and management of the advisory boards as governance. We felt that there was a lot of development work needed for our management boards to run in a similar way that school governing body management boards run, so that they are the decision makers for those centres. And that's much more pertinent in the children's centre guidance and in the inspection framework for children's centres. So when we are looked at from the inspection process, or when we are trying to deliver to the government guidance, it's through advisory boards as governance. So we're looking to work very closely with our advisory boards at a local level to strengthen them. We have aligned early years to the Vision 2018, which is the work, there's a children's work strand of Vision 2018, and we've made early years a fundamental part of that Vision 2018 process to make sure that we are future-proofing everything that we do now to make sure we get it right going forward. And again, that's a partnership offer. There's an early years steering group that we are looking to reform. We've just got an early years steering group starting to take shape that will enable us to monitor the early years as we take the service forward. Workforce development is coming through very strongly from both the review and from our staffing, who feel that we need to look at a different workforce and training modules for the future than those that we have available in the past. And we're looking at very much a leadership programme for all of our staff to ensure that we have got leaders in the future that we can take forward. The annual conversation is a DfE Ofsted piece of information, so isn't it, that isn't mandatory, but it finds its way into all of the Ofsted frameworks, that it enables you to understand, so it will enable the local authority to understand where every children's centre is currently functioning. So we've got that global picture of bringing all of that information together to look at things such as your training needs, your development requirements, and that we can have a baseline so that we can carry out an annual conversation every year and we can see what our progress is and what our trends and what our needs are. So we're looking to re-establish the annual conversation and take that forward. Information sharing protocols, we are currently looking at detailing information sharing protocols across our strategic partners, particularly with health, to make sure that we get the information that we require. That is currently kind of a little bit stuck. We're not getting all the information that we need. We need to get smarter at the information sharing as we move forward. And we have got an agreement for that to happen. We're just working through the formal processes to ensure that can happen. Data analysis will be part of leadership development so that people will understand the data and statistics, and that's how they'll plan programmes going forward. And we need to get much more keen in terms of the data and the statistics that we collect. Some of that will be tied into making sharing, but some of it will also be data that's already available that we need to use in a different way to advise our programmes. Job Centres, of course, is a statutory partner of Children's Centres, and we have worked quite hard over the summer to re-engage them in workforce training for parents and ensuring that our parents become more work ready for the future. Lifelong learning is tying into jobs to the work that we do with the Job Centres to make sure that we dovetail all of that and we're not duplicating ourselves service areas at a community level. And I talked a little bit about moving the health business in terms of the transition from not to offer that would be commissioned through the local authority. It could still be delivered by health partners, but it would be commissioned through the local authority, and we're staying very close to how that was going to move forward in terms of our Children's Centre and doing the in offer. Okay, that was a long one. Just to remind you that the core purpose of Children's Centre, taking into consideration the changes that came about from 2013, is to improve outcomes for children and their families and reduce the inequalities between families in greatest need and their peers. And that's in child development and school readiness. Hang on to those who work there, school readiness. Parenting aspirations and parenting skills, that's the parenting skills and capacity. And child and family health and life chances. So that's the focus of the service, and what that is clearly telling us is that we need to target the offer to those children most in need of the service delivery. That's just a very quick summary of our current 0-5 population and the figures underneath. I'll just explain that to you. So it's broken down by constituency area. We'll just take Birkenhead along the top line. That's saying that a snapshot of, I think that's probably about 6-7 weeks ago now, there were 6,059 children 0-5 living in the Birkenhead area. Of those 6,059, 4,192 lived in the 20% most disadvantaged circumstances. So when you talk about disadvantaged circumstances, you're talking about low income, housing with low health indicators. So the indices for the deprivation told us that 4,000 of just more than 4,000 of those children lived in 20% most disadvantaged. 80% is the rest of the children. So you can see that changes, and I don't think there's any surprises there in terms of levels of need and disadvantage and population figures. So you can see that if you go down at the bottom, there's less disadvantage in less rural, but there's still a high population of children 0-5. So there's still a requirement to still target some of our services in those areas, but the highest target for us would be Birmingham Wallasey. Just to remind us that really going right back to the onset of the short flat local programmes and then the Children's Centre, so way back to 1998-99, the beginning of planning for short flat local programmes, and later on 2000-2003 planning for Children's Centres, there was very much an alignment with regeneration around the early childhood offer. So it wasn't just about improving outcomes educationally for children, it was improving outcomes educationally for parents as well. It was making sure that parents were work ready, and it was very much in line and still continues to be in line with those welfare reforms. So it's really part of transforming communities and neighbourhoods. It's not just about Children's Centre offer something that happens inside a building. It's more about what happens within a community and growing social capacity across that community. So for instance, when Offset come out, they will look at the number of parents that are part of the decision-making process, those that sit on the advisory board, those that are volunteers, those that are moving to work. It's very much about changing communities through all of these children and their families. I'll just come back in terms of, as I mentioned earlier on, that there is a considerable and growing evidence body of research that has highlighted the enormous influence that a baby and young child's earliest experience can have on later life. and I think that the financial sense that that makes is kind of beautiful, and that again is about that regeneration. So if we can change the lives and the parameters of some of our youngest children, we will move them out of them ever becoming in need of the high-end, high-cost services that we, some of our children and families find themselves in. If you just carry on from that, Julia, I've just had a look. The Wave Trust is an organisation that's pulled together a lot of the research to help us to understand children in their earliest years. And these are six core messages that I just think are really fundamental to share. We talk about violence as a behaviour that is caused and can be prevented. What we know now is that the perinatal period, so from 26 weeks pregnant, we now know that genes are being switched on. And we talk about the nature-nurture debate. So we know that depending on what's happening externally for that woman carrying that baby, switches on genes in a very young child that can go on to form how that child functions as a very young child. So I'm thinking of things like domestic abuse and the effects that has on the newborn baby, drug and alcohol abuse, mental health and wellness, poor housing. All we now know, all of those kind of factors can. I'm not suggesting that they impact on every child, but we now know that the high prevalence of those impacts on that newborn baby. We know that the genes that baby is turning on is turning on as a result of what's happening externally to that body in that environment. We also know that it's not up there, that was just some key messages, that children that go on to display behavioural issues and start to have violent tendencies, as a lot of our very young children do, will say that we just can't manage them or that they've got some issues. Some of those is just as a real result of what's happened to that child before it was born and up to the age of two, when we now know rapid brain development takes place. So we used to think that rapid brain development was from 0 to 9. We now know that rapid brain development is 0 to 2. And I'm not suggesting that things can't be turned around, but it's dealing with those things from a very early age. But we know that those children that go on to be involved in violence are something like 17% more violent. The most violent is 17% more violent than the least violent. They'll continue, if they continue down that path, which a lot of our early indicators of behavioural difficulties start to emerge, those most violent of six will likely continue to be the most violent in their potential communities. And you have to think about that in terms of the family service, the prison population. We also know going back in terms of speech and language difficulties for some of our young children, communication issues are most likely those issues that emerge very early on in a child's school life, still in terms of that the children entering into school who can't communicate. We know that the youth offending service is about 85% of children in the youth offending service that have speech, language and communication difficulties, and that's mirrored in our prison population, particularly our male prison population. So you can kind of see that's a really quick summary, and I'm not professing to be the guru on all of this, but it does give food for thought in terms of those six core messages that we now know are available through maps, through research. And I think that the last one there, they talk about the attunement between parent and infant, and that real bonding and attachment and the issues that will emerge if those things aren't taken care of. Children there in terms of maltreatment of children has long-term consequences of the mental and physical health. So maybe what's happening to them as children, as children, is that going on when they're having their own children? So it begs the question of where early intervention and prevention starts. And I think that we've got to take account of this research when we're planning to work with those children in our most targeted areas within the borough. So those are just some things and some kind of facts. And we have a whole presentation just on those 16 messages, but it was about how we're targeting services going forward. And then if we just look at how we target some of the offer, those are the target groups, and they will vary according to the needs of each community, but are likely to include long parents, teenage mothers and pregnant teenagers, children from children from low-income backgrounds, children living with domestic abuse, adult mental health issues and substance abuse, children with offenders and adults in custody, and fathers, particularly those with mental abuse and identifying issues. So teenage fathers and those in custody, for instance. And I'm not suggesting that, that every parent who meets one of this criteria doesn't do well by the children. That's not what I'm saying at all. Those are the protected characteristics defined by the Equality Act, and families will be moving in and out of the area relatively quickly. Transient families, asylum seekers, armed forces, personnel. So those are the families that we need to be considering when we're targeting our groups. And then I just wanted to come on to the next slide that is still part of that targeted offer and would still add on to that list. But I just wanted to focus a little bit in terms of the Children's Centre or an early years offer that will look at children who are in the care of the local authority. So children who are looked after or have child protection plans and living in our communities, they should be really high in terms of our targeted groups for how we work well with these children. Children who are cared for by a member of their extended family, often as a result of a breakdown of the family, and families identified with the local authority to trouble families and where they have children who are undermined. And there is a real push to start to align those two programmes, so the Children Centre programme and the Trouble Families programme. And I'm sure it's in terms of that preventative, that very early help.